A coaching legend in college football has passed away. We go to Tony Siracusa for last word on college football, who immediately came to mind upon the passing of Terry Donahue of UCLA. Tony, how you doing today?
I'm doing well, Mark. How are you?
I am doing just fine. And, you know, we discussed this before we started to record just now. And to me, Terry Donahue and his value to college football, both in his production on the field and just his first class approach to the game and everything that surrounds the game, academics and otherwise, is very undervalued. And he passes away at the age of 77.
Yeah, look, I agree with you. His stats aren't going to blow people away, right? He won at about a 66% clip. He had 151 wins, 74 losses, and 8 ties back at a time when you could still tie in college football. That is the most wins in conference. He beats Don James by 1 win in that. And so that is the most wins. But it wasn't splashy. It wasn't overwhelming. It wasn't, he wasn't yelling on the sidelines and things like that. I've had players tell me he was exactly who you saw. He was calm. He was disciplined. He was concise and precise. And that was the way he coached. And that was his persona. I had the chance to meet him a few times as well. And that was very much who he was. And so I do agree that there was a little bit of undervalue in his legacy at UCLA, not within UCLA, but within the bigger college football picture. The people at UCLA love him unconditionally, and they always have. He was always a Bruin. He went to San Jose State for 1 year out of high school, transferred down to a community college in LA, and then spent his last 2 years at UCLA. And this was the mid-1960s, so it's kind of hard to picture as you and I think about college football in the modern day, but he was a starting defensive tackle at 195 pounds in the mid-60s. And he started on UCLA's 1965 team that won the 66 Rose Bowl against then number one Michigan State. He was what started that phrase, the gutty little Bruins. Now that grew to be a source of hatred in the program. They want to be gutty. They want to be big and powerful. But look, I mean, the guy was all work ethic, you know, to be a starting defensive tackle, even back then at 195 pounds. A couple of years out of college and working, he takes an assistant coaching job under Pepper Rogers at the University of Kansas. And then follows Rogers when Rogers came back to UCLA in 1971. Pepper lasted about 3 years and was replaced by assistant coach Dick Vermeil, and Donahue stayed on the staff. Vermeil had great success with Donahue on the staff, won the 1976 Rose Bowl against Ohio State and Archie Griffin and Cornelius Green and those guys. And then Vermeil left for the Philadelphia Eagles. And at age 31, Donahue was given the reins of the UCLA football program. It's quite a task, but you can see that line there from the time he played all the time, you know, as an assistant coach and then as head coach, and then 20 years as head coach. You know, he was a Bruin. Everything about him was a Bruin.
1976 was a long, long time ago. And even 1995, at the conclusion of his career after 20 years at the helm at UCLA. But when you mentioned Terry Donahue and him being 31 years old, it brings me back to roughly a decade later when I got to see more of Terry Donahue on a regular basis as he was bringing his team to the Rose Bowl on a regular basis.
Right.
And, you know, you get caught in the moment of your past, and and to think of Terry Donahue passing away, thinking of Terry Donahue as 77, and for a coach who got his first major breakthrough in the mid-70s, most would be much older than that, because again, as you mentioned, only 31 years old at the time. That my vision of Terry Donahue is as one of the younger coaches in college football succeeding at the level that he did in the 80s, and just to stay on that path, because I certainly want to get your thoughts about him as a man and the points that you made earlier and take us in that direction regarding what players had to say, but we'll stay on the path of wins and losses and, right. and impact on the game. But, you know, to me, who grew up in the Midwest and had a Big Ten focus mm-hmm. to a certain extent, but I always, even from the time I was 8 years old and first fell in love with college football, I had a pretty national perspective on it. I was watching, wanted to know everything, yep. dive into everything. And so I would certainly keep an eye on the Pac-10 at the time was my first. It had just become the Pac-10 okay. at that point that I started watching college football. And it would seem as though his UCLA Rose Bowl teams typically were so under the radar because they would lose a game or two early and they would fall out of the national conversation, and other teams, most notably USC, mm-hmm. usually would gather the headlines and the attention there. But here would be UCLA just, okay, getting their footing in October and November. And lo and behold, they're, despite a couple early losses, hanging in the conference race, and boom. They show up at the Rose Bowl, most notably, 1983 against an Iowa team right. that was a huge, overwhelming 10-1 team, top five in the nation, favorite. Illinois right. as right. well. Let's see. I'm getting my Michigan. Years mixed up. Illinois in 83, Iowa in 85, Michigan, that 1982 team that were major right. Factors in the national championship race, and coming from the Big Ten, were given all the attention. Here's UCLA. One of those years, they were set. I will never forget the record because it struck me as so funny being 13, 14 years old at the time. There's a team in the Rose Bowl that was 6-4-1. I was like, what right. are they doing here?
Sure.
How
sure.
did they? I got to look this up. How in the world did they get here? Well, they lost non-conference games and it was kind of a muddled race, and they made it. And then they just obliterated these teams in the Rose Bowl and showed up in on New Year's Day.
Yeah, you know, you bring up an interesting point about going under the radar because of a loss here or there during the regular season. That 75 season, they got hammered by Ohio State in the regular season. They go to the 76 Rose Bowl against the number one team in the country and the Heisman Trophy winner, and nobody in their right mind is giving them a shot. And they had Wendell Tyler running back, and Jerry Robinson was an All-American linebacker, but still nobody gave them a shot. You fast forward to the teams in the 80s, like you point out, that one year they backed in due to a tie break because of what was happening between Washington and Washington State and, you know, other matchups, and they wind up backing into the Rose Bowl and wind up winning it. They beat Michigan in the 83 Rose Bowl. Michigan had Anthony Carter then, obviously an elite level player. They beat Illinois. They had a great quarterback at the time, Jack Trudeau, who people called the throw-in Samoan back in that day. And they beat Iowa in the 86 Rose Bowl after the 85 season. They had Chuck Long at quarterback. So they were beating some quality teams. You go back to that 84 Rose Bowl and you talk about, again, the gutty little Bruins, which they didn't like, but the quarterback on that UCLA team was Rick Neuheisel. And he and several players woke up with food poisoning from a team banquet the night before. And they had food poisoning and were taking IV at halftime and before the game. And they wind up beating that Illinois team. Neuheisel throwing a couple touchdown passes to, here you go, his favorite receiver, Carl Durrell. And so there's this whole lineage that ties, you know, these Bruin guys together through the Terry Donahue era. But you go back to that mid-80s that you were talking about, and again, the underappreciation, UCLA won bowl games in 7 consecutive years during that period. Hey, they beat Bernie Kosar's Miami team in the Fiesta Bowl. They beat Emmett Smith's Florida team in the Aloha Bowl. They won 7, and not just 7 straight bowl games in 7 straight years. So it was a remarkable run during the peak of the Terry Donahue era.
And that certainly is the peak from a number of directions that you can go, and certainly from just the numbers aspect of it mm-hmm. and winning those 6 consecutive bowl games, 4 of them Rose Bowls, three of them Rose Bowls. And, mm-hmm. and you mentioned, I remember the Jimmy Johnson, Bernie Kosar right. Fiesta Bowl team.
Sure.
That was a wild, wild game, like a 39-37 kind yep. of game
yeah.
Against Miami. Tremendous game that landed them in the final top 10 in the nation. You know, they finished 5th, 13th, 9th, 7th, 14th, 9th, and 6th with those final teams under the direction of course, Troy Aikman, a quarterback.
Right.
One of the all-time greats, and a number one NFL draft selection.
Sure. You know, it's interesting too, because, you know, we're talking about those great years, and it did not start off easy for Donahue. He won his first game as head coach in 1976 against Frank Cush and the number 3 Arizona State Sun Devils. The Sun Devils were not part of the conference yet. Neither was Arizona. It was still the Pac-8, and it was a big deal, but Donahue went 0-4 against USC in his first 4 years. There were a lot of people that was not going to sit well. And frankly, if he'd gone 0-5, we wouldn't be talking about him as this Hall of Fame coach at this point. Ironically, at the end of his career, he won 5 straight against USC. Was part of an 8-game UCLA winning streak over the Trojans, but he won his last 5 games against SC. So a fitting way, you know, to end his career. He retired in 95, took a broadcast job at CBS, and interestingly, in a few interviews, admitted he probably left UCLA a little too early. He still had a little bit of coaching left in him, but he stayed at CBS for a few years. Went on to become the general manager of the 49ers. For 4 years in the NFL, and then called it quits. And he's been sick for a couple of years. He's been battling cancer for a couple of years. Not really out there in the public so much, but his players and the UCLA family has known about it. You know, he and his wife Andrea released a video about a week ago to UCLA people just saying, hey, thanks for the ongoing support. We're going to keep fighting this and so on. But, you know, he's had his wife, Andrea, by his side for 52 years. And so I think they have 3 kids and 10 grandchildren and, you know, the whole tribe down in Newport Beach.
Yeah, there was no shame in losing to USC at that time. Those were some of the more talented teams in the history of college football under John Robinson. And you mentioned his transition into the analyst role on CBS, and they just didn't throw him some games. He became the lead analyst that was calling the games that mattered, the primetime games. I believe that he was behind the mic in the 1995 Fiesta Bowl, Nebraska, Florida championship game, and some of those Nebraska, Tennessee Fiesta Bowl games that led to Nebraska national championships. Yeah, he was the number one guy at CBS and just a tremendous color analyst.
Sure. Yeah. No. And you're right. They threw him right to the big games right away, even though he had no experience. They just, you know, his mind was good enough to be able to break it down and do what was needed to be done.
So that's what we saw on the field, again, based on your interactions with him, and then more specifically, your conversations with former players. What did they have to say about him?
Yeah, I had the chance to talk to a couple of players last night, and Sean Wills, who was a running back for him for 4 years, talked about that with Donahue. You know, what you saw was what you got. He said when he came to recruit me, he never made commitments he couldn't keep. He said, you will get a shot to play. That's it. And the rest is up to you. And Wills wound up playing for him for 4 years, and they stayed close afterwards. And you saw a lot of that with a lot of these players. They would stay close to Donahue after the fact. Charles Arbuckle, who became a NFL tight end and is now a broadcaster, has stayed close to Terry the entire time. Sean Wills said it was always about the Bruin family. It was always much more than football. You know, with Donahue, Andrea would hang out after practice so that when the players got yelled at, they could go to Andrea and get, you know, some nice pleasant talk from, you know, from the coach's wife. But he was the one who said he was always concise and precise about everything. Jim McElroy, who was a receiver for Donahue for the last 2 years of Terry's career, said that that he was the true definition of the Bruin family. and was the guy who always held it together. He was the reason the players would reunite. UCLA released a statement last night from Chip Kelly, actually, which seemed really heartfelt. He said, and I'm quoting it here, "He epitomizes everything you strive to be as a coach and as a human being. Since the moment I stepped on campus, he's been an incredible mentor and one of the most authentic, humble, and toughest men I've ever met. And he loved UCLA with everything he had." You know, and it's interesting because some of these players, some of the guys who, you know, you talk about the UCLA family, and most schools talk about we're a family, you know, you're here. You look at some of the people that Donahue coached, and you look at a guy like Ron Pitts, who was a very successful player at UCLA, and then with the Green Bay Packers, his son Shea is at UCLA. So there's that legacy that continues. Or you look at a guy like Carnell Lake, who was an All-American at UCLA, obviously had a great career in the NFL. Quentin Lake is a starting defensive back at UCLA. John Shara, the quarterback from that 76 Rose Bowl team, his son played at UCLA under Donahue. So you look at Rick Neuheisel, right? I mean, Donahue gave Neuheisel his first coaching job. And while he was finishing law school, he gave Neuheisel a job as a grad assistant coach working with the quarterbacks and a guy named Troy Aikman. And that worked out pretty well for everybody. And Neuheisel eventually became the quarterback's coach, would eventually leave to become the head coach at Colorado. But that was Terry giving Rick his first job. James Washington played for, played for UCLA, had a great career in the NFL, great broadcast career. His daughter actually is a star of the UCLA softball team. There's all of this that comes back quite a bit. And there was a guy very unknown on the national scene, but was one of the most loyal assistant coaches Terry ever had, a guy named Bob Fields, who was his defensive coordinator for a lot of years. He retired. Terry wanted to keep him as part of the staff, made him administrative director, gave him a job in the athletic department. And all things come around because Bob Fields' wife was a woman named Valerie Condos Fields, who was the most successful women's gymnastics coach in college sports. So there was this keeping everybody tight mentality that really worked for Terry, and it was very much a part of who he was.
I could have come on here, done a fairly credible job based on my recollection of UCLA football and Terry Donahue's career, 70s, 80s, 90s. That's certainly in my wheelhouse of reciting scores and rankings and games and players and personnel and everything that you just mentioned. But certainly we wanted to do the man as a man and as a coach justice. And the first person I thought of was Tony Siracusa of Last Word on College Football to help us. Please check out his work, everyone, because you hear him come on here. And Tony, we received tremendous feedback on your analysis as it goes off into not just UCLA, but again, the Pac-12 and by extension college football, and your perspective, not just on what's happening on the field, but as it relates to organizations and social issues and everything that we have to deal with in this day and age. So I would, the words that Tony says, they also go to a website and are worth checking out. So please join him and the rest of the staff there at Last Word on College Football for your college football needs as we get close to the 2021 season. And certainly,
Pac-12 yes. Media Days in 3 weeks.
Coming up. You know, and we want to track you down soon for that, Tony. Definitely. So we appreciate you taking the time for us.
Always glad to do it, Mark. And just so your audience knows, this isn't mood lighting. I was trying to do it sitting next to the window in the sun out here in LA since it's still afternoon here. It's not intentional mood lighting.
Effective nonetheless, Tony. We will catch up with you soon.
All right, pal.